Hello, everybody. My name is Arun, and I run the open ecosystem team at Intel. We live in a world where distributed and decentralized software is the norm. But then open ecosystem is also becoming more and more prominent. What does open mean? Does it mean open source, open API, open hardware, open spec, open standards, open collaboration? Does it mean customers are partnering into it? Does it mean developers are partnering into it? Does it mean competitors are partnering into it? Do we compete together or do we co-opete together? I'm super excited to be here. And with me, I have two gentlemen here who couldn't be better speakers than on this topic of open ecosystem. So first of all, I have a longtime friend, James Gosling here, father of Java here.
Hi, pleased to be with you again, Arun.
Thank you. And then I have my boss's boss, also CTO of Intel, Greg Lavender.
Yeah, I'm happy to be here and participate.
Super excited. So let's get started. You know, James, when Java was created early on, it was created with this concept of write once, run anywhere. And you mentioned at earlier times, the thing that you are most proud of is the Java, the platform, as it allows multiple languages in addition to Java run on top of it. So talk to me more about that element. How much is that relevant in the current computing environment?
You know, so the notion of staying open was there from the very beginning. Our very first releases in 1995, we had all the source code in the release file.
Source.zip.
Source.zip. And even today, source.zip is in the latest releases. And you know, a lot of that was about creating a conversation between us and the developers and people who were using it. And some of it was, you know, straightforward stuff like, oh, I found a bug in this, to, you know, it would be better if you did that, to the scary ones, which were, oh, you know, there's this security issue here, it needs to be fixed, or, you know, and we got a lot of communication back and forth between Sun's engineering and every other software engineer on the planet. And you know, the one of the wonderful things that Scott did was we didn't have to go through some communications clearance process, right? We could just talk to customers. We could talk to students. We could talk to the curious. You know, we were just open about everything.
So open was fundamental, and that truly created the leveled playing field for everybody.
Yeah.
And we were tapping into the collective wisdom, collective knowledge of the community.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, when you're wherever you are, whether you're a software engineer, an electrical engineer, a mechanical engineer, you know, you view the universe from your own specialty. And, you know, we always have these issues that it's really hard to imagine how somebody who is doing stock trading or running a factory that makes sheet glass, how are they using it? What are their issues? Because, you know, as you said, you know, Java came out of a whole series of concerns that people were having. And to get at those, the communication back and forth with the community was a really, really huge issue.
Very cool. Greg, how do you think that translates to the current, you know, 25 years later, how does that translate the need for open today?
Well, I mean, I think much of the world's running on open source software. It may be delivered as software as a service. It's maybe embedded in hardware appliances. It may be embedded in software that's commercially available, but has a component of open source technology. So, and you know, we always, obfuscatory programming pioneered the idea of reuse, right? But open source is sort of like reuse on steroids, because it's not just reusing class libraries and, you know, source code definition, but you know, you're using entire open source ecosystems in your environment. Let's take OpenSSL and how ubiquitous it is. But it's also at the same time, we have a security risk, because now with concerns about the provenance of code check-ins, right, into open source technologies? Do we have some backdoor or some malware that's been inserted in there? So I think, you know, open source has that's the dark side of open source, is we've got to be vigilant about ensuring that it's working. So if you get a Heartbleed issue that happened with OpenSSL a few years ago, it was widely impacted across the industry because everyone's using it, including vendors who have it in their hardware appliances, and they have to update the software and all those hardware appliances. And then we had the recent Log4j example. So I think, you know, the whole SBOM approach that we're taking now in the open source community, we all have a role to play. And as individual contributors to open source, we have a professional responsibility to basically make sure we're writing high quality code. And also I would argue that we have to write efficient code, because a big challenge of sustainability in today's modern cloud environments is inefficiencies of the code, sort of wasting CPU cycles or being poorly written with regard to the way it, you know, copies memory or interacts with the operating system. Because a lot of developers are operating at such a level of abstraction, they've lost the, what I call the love of performance engineering. And I think, you know, that's something I've always focused on, is sort of somebody in the network, the protocol space. But in general, I think it's a great ecosystem for all of us to learn in. I used to be a university professor, and I would always have my students read open source code, because when I was an undergraduate taking an operating systems class, the professor had access to Berkeley Unix, BSD Unix code. And that's how I learned how to write a scheduler and a memory manager and how multi-process should work. You know, it's like you go look at the code. That's how, there was no TCPIP book on how TCPIP worked. You went and read the code. And so I think, you know, that's a great way to learn too, and how to, and learn, read people's good code, and you become a better software engineer and a better coder by modeling somebody else's code. I think some of the best written code I've ever seen is John Osterhout's source code for TickleTK.
Well, and another one that I really love is the annotated source code for, I think it was V7 Unix.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's, you know, it's where this professor from the University of New South Wales, I think, you know, at the time, V7 Unix was relatively small. If you printed it out, it would be, you know, a stack of paper about a half an inch thick. And he wrote a book that was essentially the source code with a column of his commentary of what was going on. And, you know, it really was a great way to walk people through how an operating system worked.
Mm-hmm.
And it's still, you know, if you can find a copy, for somebody who's never seen the insides of an operating system, that's a great document to read.
It truly summarizes to me that, you know, open source code brings that transparency, brings that integrity, and goes to Linus's law, more eyes make all bugs shallow. Because then you are truly tapping into that intellectual knowledge as opposed to the intellectual property that is there in a closed source software,
right,
essentially. So Greg, let me kind of stick with you for a second. The whole concept of Vora, write once, run anywhere, that was promoted by Java, was very relevant, and it truly pioneered that system. And we have seen how that is adopted by Docker, by Kubernetes, by multiple paradigms since then. How do you think that is relevant, that paradigm is relevant, particularly in today's modern paradigm, where we're looking at open accelerated computing, AI, you know, generative AI, and all those kind of workloads? What is the relevance of that today?
Well, I mean, this idea of open accelerated computing means, you know, let's not get proprietary about the hardware level interfaces, right? I mean, you can have what I call the level zero driver interface, but, you know, all this AI software that's written today, and we're all seeing all the exciting things about it, some of the not so exciting things about it, is really lending itself to this idea of people operating at higher levels of abstraction. If you're in PyTorch, you're not thinking too much about like how the actual code is executing on a GPU in a systolic array. You don't need to worry about that. So I think this abstraction layer that we see happening in the AI frameworks and ecosystems, much of it open source, you still want to maintain the ability to have it just run everywhere on different devices. Could be CPUs, could be GPUs, could be FPGAs or custom accelerators. So I think the basic principles that were pioneered with Java to get that write once, run everywhere, to have that play out as all this software gets adopted to enable clearly some really great technologies happening in the general AI ML space. But there's always the performance optimization side. Somebody has to do that. So at the lowest layer of the code, I'm a big fan, as James is, of course, with open source programming languages, and I'm a fan of SQL, which is a C++ dialect, mostly built on standard C++ template library.
And SQL is open source.
And SQL is open source. Run the Kronos Group stewards that. And that gives you the ability to take your code and run it on either a CPU, a GPU, an FPGA, without you having to be an expert at all that programming. Somebody else has written that code, right? And it's openly available, and anybody can read it and use it.
So you truly bring that VORA paradigm to this wide range of accelerators that are available today?
Yeah. And more will be created, because I don't think we're just scratching the surface of the computational challenges I think we have, particularly as we look at these large language models. And it's not just programming a single GPU, it's programming potentially very large scale GPU clusters or accelerator clusters. And so it all has to work seamlessly out of the box, and it has to scale horizontally, not just run on a single node.
Yeah, and there's like another axis of it, right? I mean, you know, yes, you can go from one box to another, but also the individual architectures evolve over time, right? So you take like the Intel instruction set. You know, the Intel instruction set of 30 years ago is way different than the Intel instruction set of today. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's made some huge, huge leaps forward, but most software developers don't really have to pay attention to that, because a lot of the tools will sort of paper over it, right? And I've got this one really silly test program. It's just a solitaire game. I compiled it sometime in the late 90s. And one of my things is to just say, okay, every time there's a new release or a new kind of computer, I just run that solitaire program.
So you build and compile it all over again?
No.
Or you just run it?
I just run it.
That's right.
I don't do the build and compile. I just run it. And it just gets better over time.
And that's the beauty, because JVM is making performance improvements, and because it guarantees the backward compatibility, so your code continues to run. So end of the day, it boils down to, what is the developer abstraction that is available to you? Underlying infrastructure, instruction set, hardware could change.
Yeah.
Continue to make developers successful.
Yeah, and you know, a lot of that is driven by the openness and the collaboration between, you know, the people who work on the languages, the people who work on the platforms. And, you know, so a lot of languages kind of do that as well, you know, under the sheets. Like the C compiler will adapt to different processors, although you have to do it manually. But it's still, you know, something where it actually gives like people like Intel, who do the lower levels of system architecture, the freedom to evolve. Right? You know, if everybody was writing in x86 assembly code, right? Evolution at the chip level would be really, really hard.
Completely agree. No, absolutely. I used to write that code in my university days. But so much up-leveling has happened that, you know, down the stack, somebody is doing the optimization. I can just leverage a language like Java or whatever works to my advantage.
Yeah, I mean, these days, it's very hard for a human to do a better job of writing assembly code than the compilers do.
That's right.
And we have over in modern ISA for Intel is over 3,000 opcodes. So nobody's going to, I mean, I used to know the whole set of opcodes for you know, up to probably, you know, the Pentium. And now it's like only a compiler writer really needs to know how to.
Well, you have 19,000 software developers at Intel to take care of that for you now. So you can assign it off.
Even that doesn't scale.
Right.
Agreed, though.
Well, and you know, of those thousands of them, there will be some that look identical.
Yeah.
But they aren't quite.
That's right. I said they're opcodes. Yeah, they're variants on a single instruction.
Right. You know, when somebody realizes, you know, the sign instruction had an issue. We need to fix it, but we can't break it. All right, so how can you fix things without breaking backward compatibility? Well, it's a new opcode.
Yeah, exactly.
So let's talk about a different topic. What do you think is the relevance of open governance for open source? What are the pros and the cons? You know, how should the community think about it?
So if I can take a stab at that, you know, there have been all kinds of experiences that people have had positive and negative, about different governance models. And, you know, there have been interesting incidents, like there was a, God, I forget what the tool was. There was a JavaScript package on one of the NPM distribution sites, where the guy was like, "Oh, that's so old, I'm just going to delete it." And thousands of web pages broke. Mm-hmm. Because, yeah, sure, it was old, it hadn't been changed in years, but it still worked and people were depending on it. And so that, you know, that was, you know, something that's, I mean, sure, he had the freedom to do that. It was his thing. That's fine. But, you know, at the other end of the spectrum, there are communities like the Apache Foundation, right? The Apache Foundation has a set of really well thought out rules for how you get the right to check code in, how you, you know, so, you know, they, what kind of rules do you need to have in place so that people can use your software and have some faith that it's reliable and it's secure and safe and, you know, all the different properties you need, right? And, you know, the process of becoming an Apache committer is not trivial, right? You have to sign some agreements that include things like patent protection. And the patent protection one is kind of amusing, because there have been incidents where people have open sourced code that they have patents to, but they haven't granted patent rights to anybody. And then it becomes popular, and then they go around and they say, "Well, pay for the right to use the patent, right? The software is free, but the patent is not." And, you know, the Apache folks have really thought through a lot of those issues, and so, you know, to become an Apache committer, you have to be not do that.
Yeah, and I think they have set up a really good model, you know, over multiple projects, over multiple decades now,
right,
on how that needs to work, and that seems to have worked.
Right, because, you know, it's the usual sort of delicate balance that is freedom, right? You know, you as a person want the freedom to do whatever you want, and you as another person want the freedom to not be impacted by irresponsible acts from other people.
Well, as I say, open source is free, as in puppy, not as in beer.
Yeah.
So somebody got to like take care of it, make sure this continues to work. Greg, what do you think about open governance for open source?
Well, I think we definitely, you know, I like the idea of governance as long as it doesn't become, you know, totalitarian and authoritarian.
Absolutely. So, yeah, it's a balance.
Yeah. So I think, you know, people with experience and people who've done this for a while, I think are good people to work on the governance side of it, because we do need, you know, there's always the quality control, you know, requirements. We're going to see more of that with the SBOM requirements that are coming or have been already articulated. And so I think, you know, there's no sort of liability that comes with people writing, you know, poor quality open source. But what happens is your credibility gets impacted, right? And I think, you know, what keeps the standards up in the industry is people want good credibility, right? They want good ratings in GitHub and good ratings as contributors to things. And I think, so I think we need to have, for certain areas that are critically used and everyone's using them, we need some governance for its evolution, its security, right? The provenance of where the code came from. And I think the industry's, you know, moving slowly, but we're moving more toward that model.
Absolutely. No, thank you. Well, let me bring to my last question, actually. You kind of touched upon this, James. When Java was created, that culture in the company was super important. There was a strategy, but as they say, culture eats strategy for breakfast. So the culture was fundamentally important, how Scott McNeely at that point of time enabled that culture. You know, go talk to people, remove the barriers and things like that. What do you think is the relevance of that culture element to build that open company or open ecosystem?
Well, I mean, one of the things you have to understand about Sun Microsystems back when it was founded is that it was basically a bunch of people like me who are, you know, hippies who would, you know, rather be out in the park listening to some band and, you know, the sort of flower child culture was just huge. I mean, the Grateful Dead did a concert like every other month. I mean, the Grateful Dead concerts that happened basically next to the Sun campus in Mountain View were pretty epic. But they kind of, nobody at Sun was bothered by it, right? Because half the people at Sun were going.
That's part of the culture.
Right. And you know, so it's a very open and free culture that's very collaborative, right? And, you know, you see so much stuff going on today where it's, you know, everything from the maker movement, you know, and of course open source and the GitHub communities that you find, the crazy stuff that people do on all kinds of social media, you know, there's a lot of interesting collaboration that goes on. Just like the early in the pandemic, the way that people would use some of the social media tools to create these multi-harmony sea shanties, right? You know, as a form of collaborative work, it was just amazing. And you know, the you know, if you are obsessed with customers, you know, I work at Amazon these days, and you know, and Amazon has this list of, you know, company values, and number one, it's customer obsession. That's probably why I'm at Amazon, is because they actually pay attention to customers. Absolutely. And, you know, depending on which part of Amazon you're in, your customers are different. And in my part of Amazon, it's software developers, right? And so we focus really hard on listening to people and trying to be collaborative with them.
And that's the culture that the company has.
Yeah, yeah. And you know, I think that open collaborative cultures are generally more successful. I certainly find them philosophically more amenable to me. You know, there are always, you know, dark sides to anything.
Of course. Well, Greg, as a CTO, what are you doing to bring that open ecosystem culture at Intel?
Well, I think Intel's always had an open ecosystem. It's sort of, you know, maybe had its highs and lows over the last 10 years. But when I came back in to be with Pat Gelsinger, you know, having spent, you know, 9 years at VMware, and VMware, you know, was closed source in terms of its core products, but did a lot of open source contributions, you know, and particularly in the Kubernetes area. And so I think I've always thrived on open source. I mean, when I was, a university professor, or had my own startup companies, you know, particularly during the early days of the internet, the specifications were open source, the protocols were open source, the implementations, the reference implementations were open source. And that's how the internet came about as well. People don't realize that open source built the internet. And so I think, you know, my whole career has been about, you know, both contributing to and using open source technologies to build competitive advantages, you know, through, you know, commercial products. And I think, you know, at Intel, I mean, I brought you in as the leader of our open source efforts to kind of reboot that and amplify it. And so I think, you know, it's about showing up. It's about writing good code. And at the Intel Innovation Conference, I did a little Q&A thing with, you know, young open source developers, and somebody asked me the question. They said, do I have to have a college degree in order to work at Intel as a software developer? And I said, your GitHub contributions is your resume.
Exactly.
So I don't care if you don't have a college degree, it's just your work product that matters. And I think anybody who's aspiring to, you know, be in this industry, put your code in GitHub and get people using it and contribute to other people's technologies and grow your reputation, grow your credibility, grow your skills through that. I see the downside in some of the open source that's out there is, I call it copy-paste programming, is people just copy some source file. They don't really understand what it does, but they know there's three functions that they use. And when they call those functions, the right thing happens. But they don't really understand the rest of the software that they're consuming into their product or their software that they're working on. So that's a form of reuse, but we need to have intelligent reuse, which is you actually understand the functional behavior and capabilities of that library, not just some random slap it together and, hey, it worked today, so let's ship it. Yeah. I think we need to be careful about that.
Yeah, and sort of the worst version of that from copy and paste programming, which I know it happens all the time. It just leads to trouble. But there's kind of a worse one than that happening right now. So there's all of this really cool stuff being done with generative AI,
mm-hmm.
And people are using generative AI to generate code fragments. But you know, people sometimes get in their head that generative AI is kind of like this magic thing that generates perfect code, and it doesn't. You know, it'll do the first 80-90%, but if you don't look at it and go, okay, you know, it needs to be fixed this way or that way, then you get screwed. It's like copy paste programming with a bunch of monkeys thrown in.
It's misplaced trust.
trust, exactly.
Gosh, this is such an interesting topic, and I know the discussion can go on forever. Greg, thank you for bringing me here. I know the kind of things that we do within the company to bring that culture. You know, I was amazed and blown away coming to Intel how much we have been contributing to open source, and I'm really excited. This is such an engaging panel here, and I would wish we can continue this, but I had absolute tremendous pleasure talking to both of these gentlemen here. First of all, thank you for being on the show.
Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you. I had so much fun. I hope you had too, as well. Thank you so much.